quartet will be selling CDs outside in our lobby, right outside this room. at this time, please, first of all, I'm sorry, I'm from New Orleans. Welcome. Did I say welcome? Welcome. Please turn off your cell phones and, you know, beepers. I don't know if people, we have beepers, and I'll add myself to that, you know, or at least put them on silent. Yeah. We good? All righty then. I'm Don Lewis, and welcome to the 19th Annual Satchmo SummerFest, presented by Chevron and the Hilton Satchmo Legacy Stage. This event is produced by the French Quarter Festivals, Inc. Please give make some noise with them, because they do this. Yeah, because they do this and many other charitable festivals and organization functions throughout the year. It's really a lovely group. This event is made possible through the sponsorship of community-minded organizations and the sale of a Beta beer, Jack Daniels, Sonoma Couture, Corbel, Tequila Herradura, Finlandia, Pepsi, Aquafina, Bubbly, Bayou Rum, French Market Cold Brew, Louisiana Iced Tea, and festival merchandise, which helps pay for great entertainment, security, sanitation, recycling, EMS, and production costs. And a sidebar, there's some festival-specific goods outside that you can only get at a festival. So, you know, be hearty in your spending. Please support your festival by purchasing from our beverage and merchandise booths. Do your part to keep the festival clean by using recycling and trash containers on site, and support our recycling effort by purchasing a reusable souvenir cup at our beer and cocktail booths. And please enjoy responsibly. Special thanks to the Satchmo Legacy Stage contributors like the Hilton, Harrah's, New Orleans, Joseph K. and Inez Eichenbaum Foundation, Ella Fitzgerald Charitable Foundation, the Barbershop Harmony Society, the Fertel Foundation, Ricky and Vicky Nurrigan, and Andrea Duplessis. And thank you to all our sponsors, including Chevron, Brown-Forman, Abita Brewing Company, GE, Fidelity Bank, WWL-TV, Offbeat Magazine, and so many, many, many more. Pick up a schedule so you can know where you're going throughout the festival for the performances, events, and the culinary lineup. Go grab a bite before the next act begins, and stop by the merchandise tent to purchase the official Satchmo SummerFest poster, shirts, and souvenirs. Enjoy the 19th annual Satchmo SummerFest, presented by Chevron. And happy birthday, Louis Armstrong. In the meantime, yes, please, a hand to our noble mentor. And without further ado, make some noise for him, y'all. Yes.
Here. I had a great day yesterday, heard some great stuff and some great lectures in this hall, and it just fascinates me, all the great stuff that's going on here. My name is David Wright. I am a barbershop musician, arranger, and historian. This is my good friend Vic Hobson, who is a jazz musician and historian. We both have other lives. He is an engineer. And I'm a mathematician, but never mind about that, because this is about music. But it's just great to be here. I'm very honored that we could come here and have this discussion today, because I think it has something in it that you may find interesting. So as you see on the screen there, it talks about Louis Armstrong, New Orleans jazz, and barbershop harmony, the untold story of how barbershop harmony impacted American music through jazz. Let me tell you that if you're skeptical about that, I was just like you 6 months ago, but I had an epiphany, and now I know some things that I didn't used to know, and maybe some of this will be of interest to you. We also have on stage Crossroads Quartet. They're an international champion quartet. And in this hour, they're going to be demonstrating a few licks that Barbershop sings, and we'll discuss the similarity of that with some jazz, and we'll have some jazz sound bites too. In the next hour, and I hope all of you stay around for that, they're going to present a concert right here in this auditorium, and you don't want to miss that. They are really good, and it's just something fantastic for you to hear. A little different from the other music you hear at this festival, but it has everything to do, I believe, with jazz and with Louis Armstrong, as you'll see as this story unfolds today. First of all, a little background. In recent years, we have become fully aware of the prominent role African Americans played in the beginnings of barbershop harmony. This was something we didn't know much about for many years. Those of us who sing barbershop are not historians, so we didn't care. We figured, probably back there somewhere, some black people sang this thing, but we mostly associated old barbershop with white guys with armbands and a straw hat. But as a matter of fact, there was an article, and I realized I didn't make my fonts big enough for these screens, so never mind that you can't read it. We'll make it clear what we're talking about. A gentleman who's in the audience, Lynn Abbott, wrote a groundbreaking article where he demonstrated absolutely inarguably that the African American had huge impact on the origins of barbershop harmony and in fact, were probably primarily responsible for it. He is a curator at Tulane University Jazz Archive, and he published this eye-opening article in the early 90s. I believe it was something like 1993 or 94. Lynn is in the audience. Please raise your hand, Lynn. And there he sits. And without that, we wouldn't know near as much as we do. In fact, it was Lynn's article that caught Vic's eye as well and got him started on this theme, I believe. Now, just a little bit about barbershop and its history with black Americans. James Weldon Johnson was a prominent author, educator, lawyer, diplomat, songwriter, civil rights advocate. He was an early leader in NAACP. In fact, I think he was a co-founder. He wrote the song Lift Every Voice and Sing, which is sometimes viewed as the black national anthem. And in 1929, he was beginning to worry that African-American influence of barbershop was being forgotten, that it was now just white people singing it. And he wrote this article that you see in front of you, and he recalls hearing quartets of singing waiters in his hometown of Jacksonville, Florida, when he was a small boy. That would have been the mid to late 1870s. So if there were professional quartets singing at that time, how many years before that must have there been barbershop quartets? Many years before. So you see that barbershop harmony predates jazz by at least 50 years. And he also talked about at age 15, he was in a quartet with his brother that competed against other quartets. We don't even know what he meant by the word competing. They just probably had a sing-off. But all this activity was going on in the 1870s. He said, pick up four colored boys or young men anywhere, and chances are 90 out of 100 that you have a quartet. Let one of them sing the melody, and the others will naturally find the parts. Indeed, it may be said that all male Negro youth of the United States is divided into quartets. On the right in that picture of the quartet is James Weldon Johnson. Now, along comes the gentleman sitting to my right, Vic Hobson. He wrote a book. Well, first he wrote a book 2 or 3 years ago that talked about the relationship between barbershop blues and jazz. Very interesting. I read it. My eyes clung to every page. Then he came out with this book, Creating Jazz Solo, Louis Armstrong and Barbershop Harmony, in which he went a step further. And he claimed that barbershop harmony clearly impacted the beginning of jazz. In particular, it influenced Louis Armstrong and many others. When I'm a person who sat, listen, I love New Orleans jazz and I love barbershop. I had sat and listened to jazz many, many times, and I listened to the instruments, I listened to the parts. I'm that kind of a guy. And I don't know how many times I thought, well, that baritone lick is just like a barbershop baritone. It's doing the same thing. The embellishments are just the things that barbershoppers do. The harmonization are the things that barbershop harmony does. So when I read this book, it was like an epiphany. I thought, my goodness, of course, it's the only thing that makes sense. So I'm going to turn over the mic to Vic now, and he's going to talk a little bit. Take it away.
Well, thank you, David. Well, it's good to be back again. I was here last year doing a talk, and it's even better to be back with not only David, but the Crossroads Quartet, who are going to be demonstrating some of this. So I think David's set out, certainly African Americans were heavily involved in singing barbershop, but it's the relationship to jazz that I'm particularly interested in. And another piece from James Weldon Johnson appears in his book, Black Manhattan, where he talks about a band, the Memphis Students, who were not students and weren't from Memphis either. What they were actually professional musicians. But he talks about them as the first professional jazz band on any stage, certainly on the New York stage. And the reason that he does this is not... Well, it's essentially because of the way that when they played, they also sang. And if I can read the quote here, because you may not be able to see it on the... it said, while playing the lead, someone might sing bass, and while someone was playing the alto part, they'd sing tenor, and so on, in accordance to the different voices and the instruments they were playing. So what they were doing was directly transferring these sort of sung lines onto stringed instruments. And of course, what this begins to demonstrate is the way that these sort of barbershop lines were getting transferred onto musical instruments. And it's fairly obvious when you've got a string band, as these were, mostly stringed instruments, they had one or two blown instruments. But of course, once you get to a period where everybody's got an instrument in their mouth, that relationship is no longer so obvious. It also begins to make sense of a lot of the things that early musicians say about how this sort of transition from ragtime into jazz, how they talk about sort of playing ragtime by ear. And I think it also points up the importance, I think at least, of the spasm bands in early jazz, because essentially these were string bands with people singing, playing instruments. And of course, Louis Armstrong was known to play the Swanee Whistle with his street quartet and also imitate a clarinet. So I think James Weldon Johnson's quite right about this. This probably was the first jazz band, at least on a professional stage. So it puts the history of jazz back a decade or more.
So just a little more background. Scott Joplin sang in a quartet when he was a youth. And he was so fond of that harmony that, you know, we think of him as a ragtimer, but his lifetime work was an opera. It was called Tremonisha. It wasn't even performed in his lifetime, but it was intended to reproduce the musical customs of rural African Americans in the 1870s. And he wrote right into the opera a barbershop quartet, which was four singing field hands. And he wrote the song called We Will Rest a While, which was supposed to be like they sang back then. I'm going to invite Crossroads to come forward. There's a little bit of the music that's too small for you to see, but never mind, you're going to get to hear it.
It makes us feel very good, very good. We will rest a while, we will rest a while. Soon we'll be at home chopping wood,
chopping wood.
We will rest a while. It's almost eaten time. We will rest a while. We will rest a while. 'Cause resting is very fine.
All right. Now, you may have noticed when they got to that rest a while, that big striking chord, the African-American harmonizers spoke of cracking up a chord. When they would hit on a good lick, they would love to just hold that thing. In fact, they would back up and try to get there again because they were just woodshedding in a field or on a street corner. And that is the epitome of the cracked up chord. If you like musical analysis, it's a flat six chord. If you're in the key of B flat, it's a G flat chord. And what a great piece of harmony that is. Now, others who sang Barbershop, that maybe this will surprise you. W.C. Handy, 1888, was tenor in a quartet in Florence, Alabama. They were had a quartet for trying out of new swipes. They often serenaded their sweethearts with love songs. White bloods, quote, white bloods overheard and took to hiring them to serenade the white girls. Jelly Roll Morton, recalling his Barbershop quartet, the boys had some beautiful harmony they sang. And of course, we got together and made all kinds of crazy ideas of the harmony, which made it beautiful and made it impossible for anybody to jump in and sing. Now, if you're a quartet harmonizer, you really identify that, because we don't like people singing along. It messes up the harmony. So there was. Jelly Roll Morton was a true Barbershop harmonizer. Sidney Bechet. Bechet was an avid harmonizer. He says, it was Bunk Johnson, that's a name that you jazz aficionados will recognize, who was the first to make me acquainted with Louis Armstrong. Bunk told me about this quartet Louis was singing in. Sidney, he says, I want you to hear a little quartet, how they sing and harmonize. He knew I was crazy about singing harmony. And then I'm going to turn the stage over to Vic again.
Yeah, and I think it's not only that this early generation of jazz musicians were keen on singing Barbershop, but there's also a lot of evidence that they directly related what they were singing to what they were playing. And while I was on a fellowship to the Historic New Orleans Collection, looking at the papers of Fred Ramsey, one of the authors of Jazzmen from 1939, he'd been working on a book on Buddy Bolden, which he never published, but there were some of the interview notes they'd taken from interviews. One of the interviews he did was with Edmund Wise, who was a friend of Buddy Bolden's. And he asked Edmund Wise how it was that Buddy Bolden had learnt to play jazz, because there wasn't any jazz for him to listen to at that point in time. If he was the first, how on earth did he do it? And good question. And Edmund Wise's answer is, I think, very revealing. You see, in them days, there used to be quartets and all like that, you know. Well, like all them fellas would be singing, because he had Cornish, Willie Cornish, his trombone player, was playing the trombone, and with him, he could sing. Well, they'd be singing around the bar rooms, just as they were singing. Mumford, his guitarist, he would be singing. Buddy Bolden's going to play it. Well, if they'd sing it right, he'd learn how to play it right. See, that's the part, he played it right. So what you're getting there is this idea of, you know, the quartet singing and Buddy Bolden just picking off the notes, picking off the lines. And that's how at least Edmund Wise is explaining the origins of jazz and how he came to be seen as the first man of jazz. Another informant, and this was from an autobiography that Louis Kephard, Freddie Kephard's brother, began to write. It was never published. I think it's just a manuscript that I think Lynn Abbott found for his article on Barbershop. Louis Kephard, who was active in the brass bands in the early part of the century, said that one member of the band would give an idea and they would memorise, that is to say harmonise, behind them. Of course, we could only do that because we could chord with one another. That's what made it sound good. We'd organise like a quartet, like six or five or four men, bass, baritone and alto. Everybody's got their own part. So he's quite directly saying this is what they're doing. They're actually organising in that way. And it wasn't confined to the African-American musicians. George Brown is talking in the 1950s about how when old New Orleans musicians got together at that point in time, he'd say that, you know, the musicians would play on three-way harmony, on trombones and trumpets. They'd specialise in that harmony. That's pretty stuff. Of course, it's Barbershop. A lot of these progressive guys call it corny or hicky, but that's what started music. So, obviously, once you're into that sort of bebop period, people are looking down their nose at this, but even the white musicians know exactly where this music comes from. It comes from Barbershop. And I'll hand back over to David.
So, one of those harmonizers, as we've said, was Louis Armstrong. 9 or 10 years old, had a vocal quartet. He talks about it in his autobiography. He talked about his quartet singing constantly. Every time he was interviewed, he explained how his quartet singing influenced his playing. And he said things like, when I picked up the horn, I was just doing the same thing as when I was harmonizing on the street. So there it is, straight from the horse's mouth, so to speak. So he was singing for tips on Rampart Street and Storyville section, which is right up here, I guess, northwest of the French Quarter. It doesn't exist anymore. And he remembered the other quartet members. He named them, and he named specific songs that they sang. I'll talk more about that in a minute, because we're going to listen to a couple of them via Crossroads. His life was altered on New Year's Eve, 1913, when out singing with his quartet, he fired a blank from a revolver, quote, borrowed from his stepfather. And this happened at the corner of South Rampart and Perdido Street, right on the other side of Canal Street. He was sent to the Colored Waifs home, where he lived over a year. It wasn't such a bad thing, because it was there he learned to play the cornet. The question, how much did this early musical activity affect his musical development? He repeatedly asserted its profound influence. And he named songs that his quartet sang. One of them was a song, we've never found this as a copyrighted song. It was probably a street corner song. It was called Oh, Mr. Moon. There's a lot of songs that we don't know, except quartets sang them. There's no copyrighted song by that name, but they somehow grew up on the street corner. This is called Oh, Mr. Moon, and I'll talk a little bit more about that, but I'm going to invite Crossroads to sing it. You probably can't read those notes, but you don't need to. You're going to hear it.
We can't read them either.
Oh, Mr. Moon, moon, bright and silvery moon, won't you please shine down on me? Oh, Mr. Moon, moon, bright and silvery moon, won't you come from behind that tree? My life's in danger, I've got to run. Here comes a man with a big shotgun.
Oh, Mr.
Moon, moon, bright and silvery moon, won't you please shine down on, talk about your shine on, please shine down on me. Please shine down on me.
Cute little tune. Now that does harmonically what jazz does all the time. We have something called the circle of fifths or cycle of fifths, and the harmonizers pick that up. We don't know how long they had been singing harmony that goes around the circle of fifths, but that does it. Now, for those of you who know a little music, we're in B flat. It has a G7 chord. It goes to a C7 chord. It goes to an F7 chord, and it comes back home to B flat, which is our key. That's exactly what that did. You can hear that hundreds of times in the jazz that Louis Armstrong played in the 1920s. Here's another song. He called it Down on the Amazon. It's actually, he called it something else. He called it My Brazilian Beauty. That's the first line of the chorus. It's true title, Down on the Amazon. It was from 1903, and he says that this was the song they were singing the night he fired the blank in the air and got taken away to the Colored Waifs home. So I hope that doesn't happen now, but we're going to hear this song. And David, again, you will hear
We're going to update it and call it Down on the Amazon Prime.
I didn't tell you these are wise guys standing behind me. So you'll hear the same chord sequence, which is part of the point. And let me say one other thing. Lewis said he loved the way the bass sang that gone, gone, gone. You see the arrow pointing to gone, gone, gone. So I will invite Jim to sing that with great gusto.
No,
I just wrote something that kind of must have been what it sounded like. So this is just a guess of what his quartet might have sung. But here it is.
Ba-doom-doom, my Brazilian beauty, down on the Amazon, oh, how my heart is gone, 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 gone. And every night I'm dreaming of my Brazilian beauty, down on the Amazon, down on the Amazon.
All right. Thank you. Thank you. So I don't know if you recognize, but there's the same chord sequences in that last one. Same chords and same chords you'll hear at Fritzl's, tonight or over in Frenchman Street, over and over and over again. So just to illustrate that, here's some examples of that. This first example is Money Blues, Fletcher Henderson. Listen to this. There's the same thing. Same thing. Harmonize with the instruments like barbershop harmony. And the only fundamental difference between that and barbershop is here the melody is on top, whereas barbershop tends to put it on an inner voice. But it's the same harmony. Here's another example, and this is actually vocal harmony, and this is Satchmo with a tenor harmonizing above. Now, when you have that kind of resolution of circles, you have what I call, for lack of a better term, tritone progression. The tenor and baritone will be a tritone apart on the third and seventh. The music goes across the circle of fifths. They both adjust by a half step, and now they switch roles of third and sevenths. Now, if that doesn't mean anything to you, don't worry about it. You don't need to know. But just listen to the harmony in this excerpt. That's exactly what barbershop does right there. Makes it pretty convincing when Armstrong said when he started doing jazz, he was just doing what he was when he was harmonizing with his quartet. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Vic.
Yeah, one of the real mysteries about this cycle of fifths chord progression that David was describing there is its origins. Up until now, at least, it's been widely supposed that it was developed from romantic composition in Europe. Liszt's Liebestraum number 3 from the 1850s is one of the compositions that has been cited because he uses this progression, in fact, even one stage further back than this, the 3-6-2-5-1 rather than just the 6-2-5-1. But to find a direct sort of causal link from Liszt to barbershops and also to ragtime, because this progression became so common in ragtime that it got known as the sort of ragtime progression, used as a sort of tag at the end of a tune to get back to the home key. And of course it was also used for complete choruses. That teasing rag, for example, by Joe Jordan, has a strain that is just this cycle of fifths chord progression. That goes on to become the Dixieland one step. As David says, it's absolutely everywhere in the barbershop repertoire, absolutely everywhere in the ragtime, and absolutely everywhere in jazz. And what that causal link is not clear, but I'm beginning to suspect it may well have its origins among African-American song. One example that I found that I think is reasonably convincing is from the Ethiopian quadrilles of 1848. This is before Liszt published, where you've got this 8-bar sequence that gets repeated a number of times in this particular quadrille, which is supposed to be in imitation, at least, of African-American song. And you've got this B-flat, G7, momentarily C minor, but then it goes C7, F7, and back to the home key of B-flat, or home chord of B-flat. So it's starting to appear in sheet music in imitation of African-American music making a little earlier than it starts to appear in European music, which strongly suggests to me that it's worth digging a little deeper to see what else I can find.
Mm-hmm.
All right. Sweet Adeline. Stereotypical barbershop song. It was published in 1903, and immediately every quartet, vaudeville quartet, street corner quartet, Chautauqua quartet, picked it up. Why did they love it? Because it had this improvisational possibility. The lead sings out, and everybody else improvises an echo, which happens in jazz all the time. Armstrong pointed to Sweet Adeline as a prototype for jazz counter melodies. And as I said, it was probably the most popular quartet song ever. Its famous cadence appears often in jazz. The Sweet Adeline, then that echo, Sweet Adeline. You may not be able to read that, but that's okay, because we happen to have a quartet who's going to sing. And this arrangement, by the way, was published by Sigmund Spaeth, a musicologist in the 1920s. He was just trying to represent what a barbershop quartet might sing. Here we go.
Sweet Adeline.
Sweet Adeline.
My Adeline.
My Adeline.
At night, dear heart.
At night, dear heart.
For you I pine.
For you I pine.
In all my dreams.
Now that first opening line, that echo, Sweet Adeline, Sweet Adeline, sometimes barbershop fills in fuller harmony by having the bass not just sing an octave below the lead. I'm just going to ask for the opening line again. I'm going to ask Jim, who's quite versatile, believe it or not, to sing a little different bass line that also descends with the baritone and tenor. Just the first line.
Sweet Adeline.
Sweet Adeline.
Thank you, gentlemen. You can have a seat. And you see that provides a little fuller harmony. There are many versions of these things, but that cadence is picked up in jazz so many times. And also, an early one is this cadence from the Memphis Blues, W.C. Handy 1912. You'll hear exactly that full version in this little excerpt. There it is. It's all over the place. This is... the Livery Stable Blues, original Dixieland jazz band. I believe this, people claim this was the first jazz recording made. So just listen to this. So you heard it again. And then another barbershop lick after that one. This is Alligator Crawl, Hot 7, 1927. I mean, if you start listening, those of you who like both barbershop and jazz, the minute you open your ear to this, you hear all of this commonality. This is the cadence plus the tag of the SOL blues from 1927. SOL means exactly what you think it meant. So here we go. And also, this has a little bit from the tag, the ending of it. Little variation on this thing. Again, with a little bit of variation. And listen to the ending. Now, that has something that jazz took from barbershop harmony, too, and that is, I'll take a moment to explain this, the leading tone in the harmony part doesn't go up to the tonic. Instead, goes down to the fifth of the chord to avoid a collision. That's something that most voice leading doesn't do. Barbershop harmony avoids the rules of voice leading. It says the leading tone has to go up. Well, no, because now you're colliding with the melody. Also, barbershop harmony and jazz has all kinds of parallel fifths. You know, that's against the rules in music school. But nobody came up to Armstrong's quartet and said, hey, you're singing parallel fifths. Find some other way to harmonize that. So there you have it. But the little cadence to that little Sweet Adeline cadence, and I could belabor this with 10 different kinds of little musical devices. There's not enough time for this. But then that little cadence got lifted for the famous jazz trombone fail sound. This is right out of Sweet Adeline. We all know that. Now, another aspect of the... I didn't play that right after you guys sang. then there's the whole call and echo, just the idea of leading out and following with an echo. Here's an example from West End Blues where Louis Armstrong just vocalizes the echo. He starts out by echoing the exact same thing that the instrumentalist plays, but then he goes quickly into variation. So listen to this. That line again.
What, what, what? What, 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 oh? What, what, oh? What, what, oh? What, 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 what,
what, what, what, everything ends with Sweet Adeline. Yeah. Okay, so you see, it's just the call and echo, instrumental lead out, improvisational echo, just similar to what the quartets did with Sweet Adeline. Okay, I'm going to turn it back over to Vic.
Well, I was very fortunate when I was researching the book on Armstrong that I found at the Hogan Jazz Archive a recording from 1960, where he was interviewed, and the interviewer asked him a very good question. He said, how does this sort of New Orleans counterpoint work? How is it that you've got sort of maybe three or more instruments all improvising together, all at the same time, and somehow you make something of some sort of consistent form and harmony out of it? How do you do that?
When you were playing the trumpet and, of course, improvising, and you're leading your band, actually. Does the band follow the improvisation, or they improvise a little bit on their own?
It's a good question. How on earth do you do it? And Armstrong was very, very clear how it was done.
Well, in the olden days, when the boys were reading a lot in the early days in New Orleans, they always had one in the band that could read. Either the trumpet player, the cornet player, or the clarinet player, maybe the piano player. We always had one. So we go down to the music store, that's when they before radios, and get them new piano copies, you know, tunes that just come to New Orleans. And all they do is just run the lead down once. That's how good they hear. You know, that's where the phrase comes from. The sky plays by ear.
So first of all, somebody's got to learn the melody, and that's exactly the same with the Barbershop Quartet. Somebody's got to learn the basic tune. And it's the tune, the melody, that reading musician is able to provide, that's the hinge that everything else moves around, as it were. And time and again, you find this in the oral histories, that musicians say that, you know, you couldn't have the lead instrument taking down their instrument when they're playing, because if they couldn't hear the melody, they just didn't know where they were. You went on.
So, when it's like during the First World War, when tunes like No Man's Land and Wee Wee Marie and things like that, while we was playing that on the advertising, and the guys didn't know anybody. So first thing they say, this guy's got a new tune, you know. We had woodshed all the week, and we were just drawing, and everybody pick up the part.
The interesting bit at the end there is, and everybody just picks up their part. Well, how on earth do they do that? That's the real question. We get how they sort out the melody. I hope by now you guys are getting a hint of what this might be.
That's carry me back to old Virginia. There's where the cotton and the corn and taters grow. There's where the birds wobble sweet in the springtime.
So Armstrong goes on to say, how they get their parts is no problem if you sing in a quartet.
Oh, no problem. If you sing in a quartet, the ordinary gets your harmony. If you sing baritone, you sing tenor, and I'm going to sing the lead, you bass. You understand?
And the tune that he goes on to describe is, of course, Sweet Adeline. He demonstrates it, says, here's the melody part, and here's the echo part, and finishes off by saying, and if you do it on the instrument, love the instrument. So it's absolutely plain what he's saying there. This is how it was done. And although he didn't say it explicitly, as explicitly perhaps, throughout his life, time and again he would make these comments like, singing was more into my blood than the trumpet. Well, of course it was, because that's how he learnt what to play on the trumpet. In fact, he did explicitly say when he was at the Waif's home that the reason he could play the tenor horn there was that he just played the parts that a baritone or a tenor would sing in a quartet. So, and I figure singing and playing is the same. Well, he meant that to be understood completely literally. The two were one and the same to him.
And another thing I really loved learning about Louis Armstrong is that when he was a child, he learned solfege. And that makes him a real brother to me, because I learned solfege. In fact, I learned shape notes out of the old Southern gospel hymnal. So everything is do, re, mi to me. I don't care what you low for do, that's do, and then I'm good. You can change the key, and that's perfectly okay. So he thought exactly that way when he was playing his trumpets, solos. He was thinking what the scale tone he was on, same as when he sang. And even though that voice was raspy, the more I started to listen to him and think about him as a harmony singer, he has an amazing pitch accuracy when he sings those scat lines. They're just as accurate as when he's playing his trumpet. They're just as accurate. And he really, really must have had a beautiful, remarkable tenor voice when he was a youth. So the inevitable conclusion, at least for me, I'm convinced, that barbershop harmony has a central defining role in the music of Louis Armstrong, and thereby jazz, and really thereby American music, because we know how New Orleans jazz influenced the whole American music scene. So with that, I will stop and say thank you. I want to, before you say anything, I want to also, first of all, thank Vic again for what he's done, Lynn Abbott for his incredible research. I also want to, again, plug the concert by Crossroads. And I'm going to introduce these guys, I didn't even say their names, but singing tenor is Fred Farrell, singing lead is Mike Slanka, singing bass is Jim Henry, and singing baritone is Theo Hicks. They're going to be singing next hour. Please stay, and thank you all very much for being here.
Thank you so much, Mr. Wright, Mr. Hobson, and the Crossroads Quartet. Make some more noise for them, y'all. An energetic, informed presentation. Thank you so much. And once again, the Crossroads Quartet has CDs for sale in the hall. And we'll hear from them again in a very short period of time.
Thank you.
Hello. This is Robin Barnes, the songbird in New Orleans. Welcome to the 19th annual Satchmo SummerFest, presented by Chevron and the Hilton Satchmo Legacy Stage. This event is produced by French Quarter.